To the town of our free rode a stranger one fine day. Hardly spoke to folks around him, didn't have too much to say. No one dared to ask his business, no one dared to make a slip. The stranger there among them had a big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. It was early in the morning when he rode into the town. He came riding from the south side, slowly looking all around. He's an outlaw loose and running, came the whisper from each lip. And he's here to do some business with a big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. In this town there lived an outlaw by the name of Texas Red. Many men had tried to take him, and that many men were dead. He was vicious and a killer, though a youth of 24, and the notches on his pistol numbered 1 in 19 more. 1 in 19 more. Now the stranger started talking, made it plain to folks around. Was an Arizona ranger, wouldn't be too long in town. He came here to take an outlaw back alive or maybe dead. And he said it didn't matter, he was after Texas Red. After Texas Red. Wasn't long before the story was relayed to Texas Red. But the outlaw didn't worry, men that tried before were dead. 20 men had tried to take him, 20 men had made a slip. 21 would be the ranger with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. The morning passed so quickly, it was time for them to meet. It was 11:20 when they walked out in the street. Folks were watching from the windows, everybody held their breath. They knew this handsome ranger was about to meet his death. About to meet his death. There was 40 feet between them when they stopped to make their play. And the swiftness of the ranger is still talked about today. Texas Red had not cleared leather, for a bullet fairly ripped. And the ranger's aim was deadly with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. It was over in a moment, and the folks had gathered round. There before them lay the body of the outlaw on the ground. Oh, he might have went on living, but he made one fatal slip when he tried to match the ranger with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. Big iron, big iron. When he tried to match the ranger with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip.
Town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina, music would play and Felina would whirl. Blacker than night were the eyes of Felina, wicked and evil while casting a spell. My love was deep for this Mexican maiden, I was in love, but in vain I could tell. One night a wild young cowboy came in, wild as the West Texas wind. Dashing and daring, a drink he was sharing with wicked Felina, the girl that I love. So in anger I challenged his right for the love of this maiden. Down went his hand for the gun that he wore. My challenge was answered in less than a heartbeat. A handsome young stranger lay dead on the floor. Just for a moment I stood there in silence, shocked by the foul evil deed I had done. Many thoughts raced through my mind as I stood there. I had but one chance, and that was to run. Out through the back door of roses I ran, out where the horses were tied. I caught a good one, it looked like it could run. Up on its back and away I did ride, just as fast as I could, from the West Texas town of El Paso out to the badlands of New Mexico. Back in El Paso, my life would be worthless. Everything's gone in life, nothing is left. It's been so long since I've seen the young maiden. My love is stronger than my fear of death. I saddled up and away I did go, riding alone in the dark. Maybe tomorrow a bullet may find me. Tonight nothing's worse than this pain in my heart. And at last here I am on the hill overlooking El Paso. I can see Rosa's cantina below. My love is strong and it pushes me onward. Down off the hill to Felina I go. Off to my right I see five mounted cowboys. Off to my left, right, a dozen or more. Shouting and shooting, I can't let them catch me. I have to make it to Rose's back door. Something is dreadfully wrong, for I feel a deep burning pain in my soul. Though I am trying to stay in the saddle, I'm getting weary, unable to ride. But my love for the leader is strong, and I rise where I've fallen. Though I am weary, I can't stop to rest. I see the white puff of smoke from the rifle. I feel the bullet go deep in my chest. From out of nowhere, Felina has found me, kissing my cheek as she kneels by my side. Cradled by two loving arms that I'll die for, one little kiss and Felina goes. When I was but a young man, I was wild and full of fire. A youth within my teens, but full of challenge and desire. I ran away from home and left my mother and my dad. I know it grieved them so to think their only boy was bad. I fell in with an outlaw band, their names were known quite well. How many times we robbed and plundered, I could never tell. This kind of sinful living leads only to a fall. I learned that much and more the night I heard my master call. One night we rustled cattle, 1,000 head or so, and started them out on the trail that leads to Mexico. But a norther started blowing and lightning flashed about. I thought someone was calling me, I thought I heard a shout. Then at that moment lightning struck not 20 yards from me, and left there was a giant cross where once there was a tree. And this time I knew I heard a voice so sweet and strange, a voice that came from everywhere, a voice that called my name.
So frightened I was thinking of sinful deeds I'd done. I failed to see the thousand head of cattle start to run. The cattle they stampeded were running all around. My pony ran but stumbled and it threw me to the ground. I felt the end was near, that death would be the price, when a mighty bowl of lightning showed the face of Jesus Christ. And I cried, oh Lord, forgive me, don't let it happen now. I want to live for you alone, oh God, these words I vow. My wicked past unfolded, I thought of wasted years, when another bowl of lightning killed 100 head of steers. And the others rushed on by me, and I was left to live. The master had a reason, life is his to take or give. A miracle performed that night, I wasn't meant to die. The dead ones formed a barricade, at least 6 or 7 high. Right behind it there was I, afraid but safe and sound. I cried and begged for mercy, kneeling there upon the ground. A pardon I was granted, my sinful soul set free. No more to fear the angry waves upon life's stormy sea. Forgiven by the love of God, a love that will remain. I gave my life and soul the night the Savior called my name.
Down to this southern town last summer to show the folks a brand new way of life. But all you've shown the folks around here is trouble, and you've only added misery to their strife. Your concern is not to help the people, and I'll say again, though it's been often said, your concern is just to bring discomfort, my friend, and your policy is just a little red. Now ain't I right?
Yeah, you're right. And you're right.
It matters not to you how people suffer, and should they, you consider that a gain. You bring a lot of trouble to a town and then you leave. That's part of your communistic game. I detect a little communism. I can see it in the things you do. Communism, socialism, call it what you like, there's very little difference in the two. Now ain't I right?
Ain't you right? Ain't you right?
Your followers sometimes have been a bearded, bathless bunch. There's even been a minister or two, a priest, a nun, a rabbi, and an educated man have listened and been taken in by you. All the country's full of two-faced politicians who encourage you with words that go like this. Burn your draft card if you like, it's good to disagree. That's a get-acquainted communistic kiss. Now ain't I right?
Ain't you right? Ain't you right?
One politician said it would be nice to send some blood and help the enemy in Vietnam. That's what he says, here's what I say, let's just keep the blood. Instead, let's send that politician mad. Let's rid the country of the politicians who coddle tramps that march out in our streets, protesting those who want to fight for freedom, my friend. This kind of leader makes our country weak. Now, ain't I right?
Ain't you right? Ain't you right?
Let's look and find the strong and able leaders. It's time we found just how our neighbors stand. If we're to win this war with communism, let's fight it here as well as Vietnam. Let's rise as one and meet our obligations, so communistic boots will never trod across the fields of freedom that were given to us with the blessing of our great almighty God. Across the fields of freedom that were given to us with the blessing of our great almighty God.
Well, he walks out in the arena, all dressed up to the brim. Said he just came down from a place called Highland Rim. Well, he said he came to ride the horse, the one they call the Brute. But he didn't look like a cowboy in his continental suit. We snickered at the way he dressed, but he never said a word. He walks on by the rest of us as if he hadn't heard. $1,000 went to the man that could ride this wild cayuse. I mean, a horse was never born than the one they called a Brute. The horse that he was looking for was in chute number 8. He walked up very slowly, put his hand upon the gate. We knew he was a thoroughbred when he pulled a sack of dukes from the inside pocket of his continental suit. Well, he rolled himself a quirly and he let it standing there. Blew himself a smoke ring and he watched it disappear. We thought he must be crazy when he opened up the gate. Standing just inside was 1,500 pounds of hate. The buckskin tried to run him down, but the stranger was too quick. He stepped aside and threw his arms around the horse's neck. And he pulled himself upon the back of the horse they called a Brute. Set like he was born there in his continental suit. The Brute's hind end was in the air, his front end on the ground. Kicking and a squealing, trying to shake the stranger down. But the stranger didn't give an inch, he came to ride the Brute. And he came to ride the buckskin in a continental suit. Well, I turned around to look at Jim, and he was watching me. He said, I don't believe the crazy things I think I see, but I think I see the outlaw, the one they call the Brute, ridden by a cowboy in a continental suit. The Brute came to a standstill, ashamed that he'd been rode by a city cowboy in some continental clothes. The stranger took his money, and we don't know where he went. We don't know where he came from, and we haven't seen him since. The moral of the story, never judge by what they wear. Underneath some ragged clothes could be a millionaire. Everybody listen, don't be fooled by this galoot. This sure enough bronc buster in a continental suit.
Nobody knew where he came from. They only knew he came in. Slowly he walked to the end of the bar and he ordered up one slug of gin. Well, I could see that he wasn't a large man. I could tell that he wasn't too tall. I judged him to be about 5'3" and his voice was a soft Texas drawl. Said he was needing some wages before he could ride for the West. Said he could do most all kind of work. Said he could ride with the best. There in his blue eyes was sadness that comes from the need of a friend. And though he tried, he still couldn't hide the loneliness there deep within. Said he would work through the winter for 30 a month and his board. I started to say where he might land a job when a fella came in through the door. And I could tell he was looking for trouble for the way that he came stomping in. He told me to leave Shorty there by himself, come down and wait on a man. The eyes of the little man narrowed, the smile disappeared from his face. Gone was the friendliness that I had seen, and a wild look of hate took its place. But the big one continued to mock him, and he told me that I had better go. Find him a couple of glasses of milk, and then maybe Shorty would grow. When the little man spoke, there was stillness. He made sure that everyone heard. Slowly he stepped away from the bar, and I still remember these words. Oh, it's plain that you're looking for trouble. Trouble's what I try to shun. If that's what you want, then that's what you'll get. 'Cause cowboy, we're both packing guns. His hand was already positioned, his feet wide apart on the floor. I hadn't noticed, but there on his hip was a short-barreled Bat 44. It was plain he was ready and waiting. He leaned a bit forward and said, when you call me Shorty, say, Mister, my friend, maybe you'd rather be dead. In the room was a terrible silence as the big one stepped out on the floor. All drinking stopped and the tick of the clock said death would wait 10 seconds more. He cursed once or twice in a whisper, and he said with a snarl on his lips, nobody's mister to me, little man. And he grabbed for the gun on his hip. But the little man's hand was like lightning. The Bat 44 was the same. The 44 spoke and he sent lead and smoke, 17 inches of flame. Oh, the big one had never cleared leather, beaten before he could start. A little round hole had appeared on his shirt. The bullet went clear through his heart. The little man stood there a moment, then holstered the Bat 44. It's always this way, so I never stay. Slowly he walked out the door. Nobody knew where he came from. They won't forget he came by. They won't forget how a 44 gun one night made the difference in size. As for me, I'll remember the sadness shown in the eyes of the man. If we meet someday, you can bet I will say that it's me, Mr. Shorty, your friend.
When I hear the rain coming down, it makes me sad and blue. Was on a rainy night like this that Flo said we were through. I told her how I loved her and I begged her not to go. But another man had changed her mind, so I said goodbye to Flo. Alone within my cell tonight, my heart is filled with fear. The only sound within the room is the falling of each tear. I think about the thing I've done. I know it wasn't right. They'll bury Flo tomorrow, but they're hanging me tonight. They're hanging me tonight. That night he came and took my Flo and headed into town. I knew I had to find this man and try to gun him down. As I walked by a dim cafe and I looked through the door, I saw my Flo with her new love, and I couldn't stand I couldn't stand no more. I took my pistol from my hip, and with a trembling hand I took the life of Pretty Flo and that good-for-nothing man. That good-for-nothing man. I think about the thing I've done. I know it wasn't right. They'll bury Flo tomorrow, but they're hanging me tonight. They're hanging me tonight.
Yippee-i-a, yippee-i-o, Ghost Riders in the sky. An old cowboy went riding out one dark and windy day. Upon a ridge he rested as he went along his way. When all at once a mighty bunch of red-eyed cows he saw plowing through the ragged sky. And up a cloudy draw. Yippee-i-a, yippee-i-o, Ghost Riders in the sky. Brands were still on fire and their hooves were made of steel.
Yippee-i-yay.
Their horns were black and shiny and their hot breath he could feel. A bolt of fear went through him as they thundered through the sky. He saw the riders coming hard, and he heard their mournful cry. Yippee-i-yay. Riders in the sky. Their faces gone, their eyes were blurred, their shirts all soaked with sweat. They're riding hard to catch that herd, but they ain't caught them yet. Cause you gotta ride forever on that range up in the sky, on horses snorting fire. As they ride on, hear the cry. Yippee-i-a, yippee-i-o, Ghost Riders in the sky. As the riders went on by him, he heard one call his name.
Yippee-i-a.
If you want to save your soul from ever riding on our reins, then cowboy, change your way today, or with it you will ride, trying to catch the devil's hood across the endless skies. Yippee-i-a, yippee-i-o, Ghost Riders in the sky. Ghost Riders in the sky.
In the southern part of Texas, in the town of San Antone, is a fortress all in ruins that the weeds have overgrown. You may look in vain for crosses and you'll never see a one, but sometimes between the setting and the rising of the sun,
You can hear a ghostly bugle as the men go marching by. You can hear them as they answer to that roll call in the sky. Colonel Travis, Davy Crockett, and 180 more. Captain Dickinson, Jim Bowie, present and accounted for. Back in 1836, Houston said to Travis, get some volunteers and go fortify the Alamo. Well, the men came from Texas and from old Tennessee, and they joined up with Travis just to fight for the right to be free. Indian scouts with squirrel guns, men with muzzle loaders, stood together heel and toe to defend the Alamo. You may ne'er see your loved ones, Travis told them that day. Those who want to can leave now, those who fight to the death, let them stay. In the sand he drew a line with his army saber. Out of 185, not a soldier crossed the line. With his banners a-dancing in the dawn's golden light, Santa Anna came prancing on a horse that was black as the night. Sent an officer to tell Travis to surrender. Travis answered with a shell and a rousing rebel yell. Santa Anna turned scarlet, played to Quelo, he roared, I will show them no quarter, everyone will be put to the sword. 185, holding back 5,000. 5 days, 6 days, 8 days, 10. Travis held and held again. Then he sent for replacements for his wounded and lame. But the troops that were coming never came, never came, never came. Twice he charged, then blew recall on the fatal third time. Santa Anna breached the wall and he killed them one and all. Now the bugles are silent and there's rust on each sword, and the small band of soldiers lie asleep in the arms of the Lord. In the southern part of Texas, near the town of San Antonio, like a statue on his pintle rides a cowboy all alone. And he sees the cattle grazing where a century before Santa Anna's guns were blazing and the cannons used to roar. And his eyes turn sort of misty and his heart begins to glow, and he takes his hat off slowly to the men of Alamo, to the 13 days of glory at the siege of Alamo.
I was hanging around town, just spending my time, out of a job, not earning a dime. A feller steps up and he said, I suppose you're a bronc fighter from the looks of your clothes. You figures me right, I'm a good one I claim. Do you happen to have any bad ones to tame? Said he's got one, a bad one to buck. For throwing good riders, he's had lots of luck. I gets all head up and I ask what he pays to ride this old nag for a couple of days. He offered me 10 and I said, I'm your man. A bronc never lived that I couldn't fan. He said, get your saddle, I'll give you a chance. In his buckboard we hops and he drives to the ranch. I stayed until morning and right after Chuck I stepped out to see if this outlaw can buck. Down in the horse corral standing alone is an old Cavallo, a strawberry roan. His legs are all spavined, he's got pigeon toes, little pig eyes and a big Roman nose, little pin ears, that touch at the tip. A big 44 brand was on his left hip. You neck and all with a long lower jaw. I could see with one eye he's a regular outlaw. I gets the blinds on him and it sure is a fright. Next comes my saddle and I screws it down tight. Then I steps on him and I raises the blind. Get out the way, boys, he's gonna unwind. He sure is a frog walker, he heaves a big sigh. He only likes wings for to be on the fly. He turns his old belly right up to the sun. He sure is a sunfish and son of a gun. He's about the worst bucker I've seen on the range. He'll turn on a nickel and give you some change. He hits on all fours and goes up on high. Leaves me a spinning up there in the sky. I turns over twice and I comes back to earth. I lights into cussing the day of his birth. I know there are ponies that I cannot ride. There's some of them left, they haven't all died. I'll bet all my money, the man he lied, that'll stay with old Strawberry when he makes his high dive.
When I hear the rain a-coming down, it makes me sad and blue. Was on a rainy night like this that Flo said we were through. I told her how I loved her and I begged her not to go. But another man had changed her mind, so I said goodbye to Flo. Alone within myself.